Bola Tito, are you there?
Yes, she's here.
Will she share the presentation, or should I share that?
I mean, you can always share it so I can control. But if not, we can also share from our end. But if you can, you can always share. Yeah, you can control. Okay, fine.
I can do that.
Okay, then that's great.
So, okay. Good. So, thank you everyone for joining in, and I'll just try and take us through a quick set of points to try, because productivity and process is those are two very long and winding topics. So I'll just try and, within the short time we have, try and do more of an introduction and give some pointers that I guess people can easily take back to implement within the companies. Now, the concept of productivity is, it's all about being able to optimize resources. So if you are a business owner, if you are planning to start a new venture, you have an existing business you are running, productivity is important, and that applies whether you are looking at manufacturing or making products or you're just offering services, because productivity is about using a certain amount of resources to provide a certain amount of outputs. Now, using your resources optimally is what productivity is all about. Now, I'll try and play this short video, which gives a quick overview of what production is. Sorry, of what productivity is. So just a minute, I need to reshare this. So I think I will share the link to that video because it's on YouTube, so anyone can actually go back and watch it. So let me continue with the presentation. Right, so from that video, you see that she has a business making birdhouses. And as a manufacturing process or as an operation, you have a number of things. So she has her inputs, the processes or the process she uses to make the birdhouses and the output, which is the finished product. Now, productivity is about how to bring those inputs and take them through a process to give an output optimally. Because so you could have two businesses doing the same thing, using the same resources, but one is able to produce 10 birdhouses while the other person produces just 5. So that's basically how you look at the differences in productivity. Now, this might seem like a very simple and straightforward thing to say, oh, it's just birdhouses, or it's just a difference in production. But that is actually what makes the difference between winners and losers in business. Now, looking at the concept of processes, a process is a defined sequence of steps or activities that you follow to achieve a task. So it could be anything. It could be trying to boil an egg. You can have a fixed process for that. Now, for businesses, it's very important to write down and document your processes. So you must define them clearly. There are so many advantages for having processes in your business. Some of them is that it gives you a basis to start from. You can't improve anything if you don't have a process, because if you do it, so imagine that you have a business where you have an activity that you are performing and you have 5 colleagues that perform those activities. If you have a situation where each of those 5 people will perform those activities in their own particular way, then you don't have a process and you can't improve it, because if you have Mr. A doing it in one way, you have Mr. B doing it in one way, you have Mr. C and all that, it means that you have like 5 processes. Which one are you going, which is the best? Which one are you going to optimize? So processes are quite important. So you have to define, you have to test the process, and then you have to document it, because it's like nailing it down. Now, okay, I've talked about why it's important, but we can still look at them here. As you can see from the slide, it provides consistent output, it reduces waste, provides a basis for continuous improvement. That's what I was just talking about. It makes training easy, because if you have a process, if you've documented it correctly, when you have a new employee join the business, it makes it easy for you to quickly put the person through to say, this is how we do it. Now, a lot of businesses miss this point. And you bring someone in and say, oh, it's very easy. Just find your way, you will do it. You are a sharp guy now. Just find a way to do the work. The problem with that is that you begin to have problems with consistency. So a typical and very good example of this is a company like McDonald's. They sell burgers, but people know that McDonald's don't make the best burger. So people don't go to McDonald's because their burgers taste the best. People go there because there is consistency. So you know what to expect. It's not the best, but it's not so bad. And you know that if you go to, say, a state in the US, say, I don't know, New York, and you go and eat their burger, you travel to Houston and you eat their burger, you get the same taste. So you are satisfied. And it's also similar with a bottle of Coke. If you buy a bottle of Coke, you travel to Kaduna, for example, you buy a bottle of Coke, it will taste the same way to you with a bottle of Coke that you'll have bought in Abuja or in Lagos. And Why is it that way? Because they have a fixed process of producing those things. And setting up processes can be cumbersome, but the benefits way outweigh the cons. Now, coming back to why they are important, you see that it says it supports quality requirements and goals. That's very, very critical. You can't have good quality without a process. Like the example I gave about McDonald's, they don't make good burgers by employing the best cooks. So they don't rely on the knowledge of the workers. They rely on the process. All right, moving on. How do you define a process? When defining a process, you take time to ensure that each step adds value. Now, the concept of value addition in an operation is very critical. You can have an operation where there are many non-value adding steps. So imagine, I'm trying to look for a good example. Imagine an operation or an assembly line, yes. Imagine an assembly line where someone sits at his desk to assemble, say, a phone. I'm trying to assemble my phone. But the components I need are on the other side of the room. So that means for every component I need to assemble something on my phone, I need to walk to the other side of the room to bring the component and assemble. Now, that process of me walking to go and get that part, even though I need the part to make the assembly, I actually don't need to walk to get it if I had arranged all the things I needed beside me. So a value adding step is a step that actually adds value, because what the customer is going to pay for is the end product. The customer doesn't pay for you walking around to get the things you need. So as a business, it's your responsibility to ensure that as much as possible, you eliminate any activity that doesn't really add value to the process of achieving your goal. So looking at the slide, you will see you need to understand the business goal. What is the business goal? If the business goal is to say you are making, let's say you're making chin-chin, you need to define it clearly. What are you supplying your customer? You are supplying chin-chin with a particular taste or a particular flavor packed in a particular way. Then you now need to identify what are the tasks that are important to meeting your goal. And it's at this point you now start thinking of what are the tasks that you have been carrying now that don't actually add value to your goal. So in looking at all these things, you now start looking at how do I arrange my work environment to ensure that I don't waste time doing things that don't really add value. Then after you've done all that, you now assign the task to the people that will do them, because you have different things. So for example, you need to mix the flour, if you're making chin-chin, for example. Then you probably have to, I think, dice. Well, no, you have to mix it, then you have to dice, you have to fry it or something. So if you have different people performing those tasks, you now need to assign the tasks to the different people. Now, when you have different people assigning tasks, remember that each person must have his own process. So in the case of McDonald's that I talked about, where you say, for example, you make potato chips potato chips. And you say, what they actually do is that they make sure that, for example, your inputs are important. So they'll say, the kind of potatoes we use are defined. They must come from a particular farm. They must be of the same breed. For a typical person, nobody even cares. Okay, if you go to the market, you don't ask the lady in the market, what breed is this potato? You don't bother to ask. But for companies like McDonald's, because they want to maintain the consistency in the taste of their product, they make sure that the potato is the same breed, probably buying from a handful of farmers only. They have a process for dicing for cutting the potato into a particular size, because it must be a particular size, because if some are bigger than others, when you are frying, you begin to have problems, because when they are frying is just a timing thing. So you have a cooking set where the oil has a temperature, like a temperature sensor that tells you that, okay, it's at the right temperature. You measure a particular quantity of potato, you pour it into the oil, and then you wait for the timer. Once the time is up, you don't need to, it's not like when you say, oh, is it brown enough? Let me taste it. Is it nothing like that? Because the process just says, wait for this amount of time, remove it from the oil, drain it, pour it, put the next batch, and you just follow the process. So you can come into the business, you've never fried potato before. They just tell you, once you know how to follow the process, you will always provide the required output. Now, after you've assigned the tasks, you test the process. So you run through it to see, okay, are there any bottlenecks? Are there any issues? Once you've done that, then you begin to implement. And then as you implement, you monitor. You monitor, and then you then standardize and improve. Because as you are monitoring, you might find ways or come up with better ideas to reduce your waste. And you continue to do that until you optimize and optimize. Now, if you do this well, this becomes like a source of competitive advantage for your business, because people will see you selling your chinchin and say, oh, the chinchin is so good. This person must be very good in making chinchin. But the truth is that in a business, if you start the business, so maybe for the first few months of your business, you don't have a lot of customers and you're frying your chinchin by yourself. So you are taking care, you are careful. So let's assume that you produce, let's say, 100 kg of chinchin every week. That's the capacity you are selling. And your business begins to grow, and all of a sudden you need to produce 1,000. You can't do them yourself anymore. And you can't duplicate yourself, which means you have to trust people to come into your business to do some of those tasks. That's where the process comes in. So basically, the process means that the things you've been doing so well that has grown your business, you write them down. You make them clear, so that when you begin to bring others in to perform some of those tasks, they will only be repeating what you've always done before. And in that way, you retain the quality and the consistency that has allowed your business to grow. Now, there's also the concept of process mapping. Process mapping is like when you go through, like what I just explained now, as your business is growing, now you need to bring people in. You used to mix your flour before, you used to cut, you used to fry, you pack, you do everything yourself. Now the business has grown. You can't even go to buy the flour anymore. So you now need people to do some of the things that you were doing by yourself. Process mapping is the process of you now sitting down to say, okay, I'm going to itemize everything I've always done in this business. I'll put everything on paper and decide, how do I now break them into packets of processes where I can assign to different people? So the example in the presentation talks about making pap. It's a process that requires you will boil water to a particular temperature. You make a paste of the pap while you are heating up the water. Then you pour the water and then mix. You can decide to add whatever beverage you want. Now, if you don't define this process clearly, because others can do it in various ways. So for example, some might decide to say, okay, I will put the water on to boil. I'll stand there and wait for it. When it finishes boiling, when I know it's boiling, then I begin to mix the pap paste. Then when I finish mixing, before I pour the water in. But if you're a process person and you're trying to optimize, clearly there's a problem there already, because while the water is boiling, you could have been doing other things. You can mix and stir the pap, you can bring out the beverage. So you can do so many things. And that's actually what process optimization is all about. When you look at a process and there are certain activities that can be done in parallel, you begin to see that, okay, if I don't try to compress these things and do them in parallel, I lose time. A shift is 8 hours. So if you begin to drag activities, you lose that time. And as a business, you'll always remember that if you are using, say, a machine, and the machine is idle. In fact, let's even assume you don't even have a machine, because some people might say, well, I don't have a machine. If you are renting an office or a building, the amount of output you can bring out of that building is what determines how much money you make from the because your rent is fixed. So let's assume you have a rent of, I don't know, 5 million per annum. If you are frying chin chin and your total output per annum is, say, let's say 100,000 kg of chin chin, for example, optimization and productivity means, how can I pay this same rent of 5 million but produce 200,000 kg of chin chin? Using the same resources to do more, and in that way, grow your profitability. You can grow your profitability, and as your process is optimizing, and because basically what it means is that your cost of production is dropping. You can then even go back to your customers and say, oh, I used to sell 1 kg of chin chin for 2,000 naira before, but I'm going to drop my price to 1,800. If your competitors cannot match you, it means that people will start buying your product more, which then comes back to mean that, oh, your demand grows. So you begin to take over the market. If your competitor doesn't know about process optimization and they are still following their own slow process and they decide to compete with you on price, they start losing money. Meanwhile, you're actually making more money because you're using the same resources to make more. So you begin to see a clearer picture as to how process optimization and productivity can help you gain market advantage over over the competition. Now, there's also the concept of lean. Lean is, this is a concept that was started by Toyota. Now, a lot of the things I'm talking about, you will see them under the concept of, there's what they call the Toyota production system. It talks a lot about lean process management or lean production. Now, the lean mindset is a method of creating and continuously improving processes throughout your organization. So, which means that you always, it's like your obsession is to find ways of doing things in a more optimal way. It's not about cutting corners or trying to, cutting corners is the best way to describe it. It's not about cutting corners. It's about finding better ways. So for example, you can optimize on using better tools. You will see that, so if you go to a roadside vulcanizer, when it's time to change your tire, they go through this process of using something to try and bring out the tire from the rim. They will heat it, hammer it, and all that. But there are better tools for doing that. So imagine that your business is changing tires and you have a long queue of people waiting to change tires. If you have the right tool that just goes in and you press a button, it just removes it in maybe a minute. Meanwhile, your competition is still using that old process that probably takes about 10 minutes to change one tire while you are doing 1 or 2 minutes. They might not know what you are doing. Maybe your machine is inside, but they just know that you are attending to a lot of cars. What's their solution? They'll say, oh, maybe I need more of these manual machines, or maybe I need more people. So thinking lean means a lot of things, but the key point is you must find a way to ensure that you do more with less. At times it might mean investing in optimal systems. So it's a lot of things, but it is unique. For every business, you must find what it is, because lean means you have a lot of fat. You need to cut out the fat. So it's a system of eliminating waste. So you will see that it talks about waste like overproduction. That's another thing. Overproduction can be waste, because if as a business, right, you see, okay, just underneath there, you see just-in-time technique. Just-in-time means just producing enough for what you need at that moment. Because if you sell chin chin and you sell, let's say, 10,000 kg of chin chin every week, if you start producing 20,000 chin chin every week, then you're overproducing. A lot of people might not see anything wrong with that, but remember that there's a time value for money. So it is always more advisable to have your money as cash in your pocket or cash in the bank than in chin chin lying around. Because you might be unable to sell and it goes bad. You've lost that. There might be a flood, for example. So things can happen to product that you are keeping. But now I'm not saying that you shouldn't have some buffer of products, but overproduction means you don't calculate the buffer you need and you just produce and just keep. The danger with that is that you might even have depreciation on the goods you are keeping. But bottom line in lean thinking is that if you don't need it, don't produce it yet. Again, you see inventory there. People might wonder, how is inventory waste? What it actually means is excessive inventory. Unfortunately, for manufacturers in Nigeria, you always have to keep a bit of inventory. We have to, because if your supply chain process, which means the time it takes to get your goods, your raw materials from the manufacturer or your supplier to you is excessively long, it means that you'll always need to have sufficient amount of those items in your stock so that you don't run out. Now, another waste we have there is motion. I explained that initially, where I talked about the tools and the resources you need to work, or your colleagues need to work, must always be around them. People don't see anything wrong with, oh, let me just walk and go and collect, let me collect a spanner from that guy. It's waste. Because what people don't understand is that 2 seconds can be waste. So I'll give you an example in our own production line. So we have a unit where we produce parts through injection molding. Now, when you're making big parts with injection molding, you have to demold the part. You need to take the produced part off the machine. Now, the way an injection molding machine is designed is that it's sort of, for protection, it's closed in. So if you've produced the part, you probably need to open the door, pick out the part, drop it, close the door, then run the next cycle. So that means every cycle, you need to open the door, pick the part, close it, press a button for it to produce the next one. But you can also use a robot. So you can have a robot that is timed to pick the part for you. And we found out that this simple process can give you the difference between producing 600 parts and producing 1,000 parts on the same machine. So, which means that, let's assume that you buy the machine for, let's say $100,000, for example. And then you say, oh, should I buy a robot with it? The robot is expensive. That's another, let's say $20,000 to spend. So $120,000, what do I do? Now imagine that without the robot, your production is 600 parts a day. But with the robot, you're producing 1,000. So that means, a quick calculation, 4/6 is what? That's about 66% more, or thereabouts, of parts that you are making. So you spend 20% additional to gain. It's almost like buying another machine. So that's why it's very important to understand that a lot of these little things that you might take for granted can really make a difference. So you might even say in the beginning that, oh, but I don't really have that much demand. Or what if your demand grows? So it's a delicate balance that you must always think of in your business. Then there's even overprocessing. That's another problem. Now, overprocessing means if you don't define the quality level of your output. Okay, let me use the chin-chin example. I'm not an expert in making chin-chins, but I'll try and use it as an example. Overprocessing means that, for example, you are frying your chin-chin. Now, let's assume that after frying it for like 7 minutes, it's okay. But you can also leave it in for like 9 minutes. It will still, maybe it will be crunchier or something, I don't know. But ideally, 7 minutes is fine. Now, if you don't have a process that defines it, that after 7 minutes you take out the fried chin-chin and you leave it for 9 minutes, it automatically means that for every set of chin-chin you fry, you lose 2 minutes. That's overprocessing. The problem with overprocessing is that your customers are not paying for that additional 2 minutes you are adding. So it's important to know your process and define it. Now, running through some of the concepts there, those are all lean production concepts. You talk about just in time, which I just mentioned earlier, doing things just when you need them. There's no need to do them ahead. Tag time is align. You need to align your tag time is the time it takes to I think to run through a cycle. So you need to align that with your demand in terms of are you producing in line with? In fact, there is in lean thinking, there's a concept of pull production, meaning that your production is done when, how do I explain this now? So your customers, imagine the chin-chin manufacturer again. It means that you've designed your business such that it is your customer's demand that determines what you produce. So you are not overproducing and waiting for the customers to come, but you understand your business so well that the customers practically pull the chin-chin out from your factory in terms of that as they are demanding, you are producing. That's the concept of pulling. 5S. 5S is a bit like what I explained in terms of organizing your work environment. If you look at a lot of production facilities, in fact, even in our own factory too, if you come in, you see that there are a lot of markings on the floor. Those things determine where things ought to be, meaning that in a production environment, things must be in a particular place. Now, why that is important is that imagine that you work in shifts. It's not proper that, let's assume that Isaac is on morning shift. He wants his own arrangement of how he wants the environment to be. Then when Joseph comes for afternoon shift, the next shift, he wants to rearrange it the way he wants. Then you don't have a process because everybody is defining his own process. And the danger with that is that you begin to have inconsistency. So one person might end up being faster in production. The quality will be different. So 5S is very, very important. And one key point of this I haven't mentioned is that it also makes your work easy. Because what it basically means is that while defining your process, you find the easiest way to achieve your task. And then you begin to repeat that all the time. You're not waiting for someone to introduce something and any trial and error. Now, Kaizen is aiming to reduce cost and increase productivity through continuous improvement. Kaizen, I think, it means continuous improvement. So when you define your process, it's not the end. You go back and continue trying to find ways to do it better. Now, in all these things, if your process is not documented, then you don't have a process. If it's not written down, forget it, you don't have a process. You cannot say you have, oh, it's in my head, I know it all. Unless your brain is connected to every worker you have in the organization, you don't have a process. So that's where you now start hearing about standard operating procedure. A standard operating procedure is a document that defines the step-by-step process of carrying out tasks. So it will explain everything. It's also very useful, I mentioned earlier, about training. Now, especially when the task is complex, if you bring in a new person, right? So imagine that you have an organization where you bring in, you're having to recruit a lot of people to come and do the same task. If you do not have a documented process, it means that imagine that I walk in now and I say, oh, I have this person to train. I don't have any document to use in training. So I'm just trying to train from memory. There's a high likelihood that I'll tell this person, so let's assume that there are like 10 topics. I might miss 7 and 2, but teach him the rest because it's not written down. The next group that comes, maybe I miss 8. So you now find that you are teaching people, but there are gaps in their knowledge. That's why you need something written down. It also acts as a reference. So people that have been, even apart from the new guys, if there's something that I'm not sure of, I've been doing this work for some time, but maybe there's something that I'm not sure because someone was doing it in another way and we're having an argument. You can just go and check. What does it's almost like the law for that process. And the one rule of all this is that you must try as much as possible to make it idiot proof. Let it be simple, let over explain if possible, so that anybody that reads it can understand. Now, we've talked about putting up a process, process management and all that. Now, the concept of process management means once you've defined all that, now managing that process. It's one key thing for everybody, for anybody that wants to set up a proper productive process. Your target is to manage the process, not the people. Because the process defines how things are done. So in fact, so you see, there's always this thinking that, oh, how come you can get very good products from Europe, for example? Oh, the quality of their products are always very good. You want to know why. Why is it that way? Is it that they are better than us? Is it that they are more intelligent? I can tell you for free, it's not an intelligence thing. It's simple. They know how to follow processes. The problem is that it's so simple that a lot of people don't even believe it. What they know how to do is to follow processes. They don't make assumptions to say, that place that I used to work before, this is how we used to do it. Let me just do it in that way. If you come into an environment, you'll be shown or taught how to do something. Your work then is to follow the process. It's so simple that a lot of people don't accept it because people expect that when I come to work, I must add my own flavor to the work. The problem is that it's in adding your flavor to the work that you damage the process and the end product. So the product that should be consistent, you begin to have different changes because you are not following the process. Now, in managing processes instead of managing people, you now begin to look at how you use resources more efficiently. Now, one thing you will see when you start doing this is that you have more data. It begins to pop up data because, so for example, if it's a process that you always have to carry out, automatically you define that this process takes a particular length of time. So you can say, okay, this process takes 100 seconds. So you always know that that's how long the process takes. Now, the trick with optimization is that since you know it takes 100 seconds, the next question you ask yourself is that, how can I shave off 2 seconds from this 100? It might look like nothing, but imagine that this 100 seconds, you carry it out like 1,000 times a day. If you shave off 2 seconds, it means that you've saved 2%. If you are repeating it 1,000 times, 2 seconds becomes 2 times 1,000, which automatically means that you saved 2,000 seconds. Remember, you've not spent any money doing anything. You've not upgraded your machine. You've not done anything. Just by watching the process and making slight changes to optimize, you save. So, moving on. Still talking about improving processes. Every process has a constraint. A constraint means the things that friction. If you hear constraints, imagine friction, things that keep it from moving, or bottleneck. So imagine your production to be a value chain with steps, different steps that you can perform to achieve your aim. Now, if those are sub-processes that join together, so one process feeds the next and so forth, one of those processes can be the bottleneck. So there's a good example there. So imagine that you have a cooker and it takes 60 minutes to cook 10 plates of rice. So you have a restaurant and you are cooking rice to serve. Or you have a pot that can take 10 plates of rice for a cooking cycle of 60 minutes, same thing. But your demand is 15 plates in an hour. That means your bottleneck is the pot that can only take 10 plates. If you improve something else, so let's assume that you decide to add more salt to the rice, it's not going to improve your this thing. If it's a restaurant and you decide to add more chairs, it doesn't help you. So when you have a bottleneck, you must identify where that bottleneck is, because the thing with producing is that you end up, it's a long chain of steps, and it's easy to miss out where the bottleneck is if you're not observing. So you must always check, because if you have a chain of processes that you must perform to achieve your target, each process will have its own throughput to say, okay, if our target is to do 10 a day, every process within that chain must do a minimum of 10 a day. Now, if you have a chain of processes, some processes might be able to do 12, some 15. So it's like, you know, when they say a chain is as strong as its weakest link, that's what the constraint is. So your constraint determines your throughput. So even if one process can do 20, if your slowest process is 10, then your throughput is 10. So to increase your throughput, you must increase that 10. So in some cases, people will decide it's okay. Let's assume that you have two machines doing 5-5, giving you that 10. To increase, you might need to add another machine to give you another 5 to take it to 15. If you increase anything else along the line, it makes no difference. So just to try and summarize, if you are overseeing production or a service, now let me digress a bit to talk about services, because it seems I've always been talking about businesses that have to do with producing things. So imagine that you're traveling, you're at an airport and you're at a check-in desk. One of the reasons why you have a lot of queue is that when you are standing and you watch the person at the counter attending to people, you find that the throughput of your line is how fast the person can perform. But you also notice that not everybody takes the same amount of time. So you can't say, for example, everybody is going to take 5 minutes to get processed. Someone might come in and say, oh, I booked my ticket 2 months ago, but there was a problem. His own will take 20 minutes. And that's why to solve that problem where you are getting served, you always will prefer to have more than one person attending to people. So that second person now becomes, you know, when we talk about constraints, one person, that's your constraint. You add a second person to increase your throughput. Now, if it's a service, automatically you will know that, okay, this is the average number of people that come into my business every day. And you also know, for example, that, okay, there's a peak period where people will come in. And that defines how you design the process of your business. So you can decide to say, okay, people don't come very early in the morning. Or okay, let's even assume that you have a shop, you sell coffee. Then you realize that, oh, people come in from about 7 till about 10 in the morning, because that's when people drink coffee. Which means that if you have like 4 serving points, you ensure that those 4 serving points are manned during that rush hour period. You can also, in fact, okay, so for something like serving people coffee, you can actually define to say, okay, it takes, let's say, 120 seconds to make a cup of coffee, just as an example. So automatically, your people or rather your customers can tell, and or rather you should be able to inform your customers to say, okay, if I have four people serving, it takes each person 120 seconds to make a cup of coffee. And based on that, you should be able to actually estimate how long does it take my people, or rather my customers, to get served. Because nobody likes waiting. No customer wants to come in and stand in line, right? So you should be able to say, okay, I don't want anybody to spend more than 5 minutes waiting. So if I know, if I have an idea of the number of people coming and I design my process, I make sure that my customers don't spend more than 5 minutes. So all that is still the same. The process of defining that is still the same thing with all the things I've said in terms of production. So whether you are running a service business or you are running a production operation, it's still important that you define processes. And you remember I said, assume it takes 120 seconds to make a cup of coffee. For you to even arrive at that, it means you've defined the process of making the coffee. Otherwise, I'll come and say, oh, I prefer my own coffee in a particular way, and my own takes about 3 minutes. So when I'm making it for the customer, I use 3 minutes. That could fall under over-processing. But when you define the process, it means that your staff that are providing the service, they don't do it how they want to do it. They do it how the process has been defined for them to do it. In that way, you ensure that your customers don't wait. In fact, apart from even waiting, the quality is also there, because if your process can be like saying, smile, say good morning, ask the customer what he wants. You must always do that. So if you walk into a shop and you see them doing that, it's because the process has been defined. Smile, greet him. Some of them might even say, oh, how are you doing today? So how can I help you today? So these things are defined. It's not for the person to say, oh, what do I even tell this next man? Ah, see, he looks tired. Maybe I should tell him something else. Oh, this one looks happy. Ah, he looks angry. Let me not greet him. It's not for them to decide. You say what you've been trained to say, and you roll with the process. In that way, it is defined. Nobody is going to say, oh, okay, your staff are not even greeting itself. They can't even greet somebody. You're never going to get that because the process has been defined. So at the end of the day, if you want your business to grow, because I'm assuming from all that I have said that anyone listening to this is looking at a business that can grow. So if you are looking for a business that will scale, scale is the key word. You're not trying to do a business where it's just like a subsistence farming. You just want to do small business just to pay school fees. No, you're looking at a business that will grow, where you will employ people and sit back and marvel at how the business has taken a life of its own. You cannot do that without processes. I can guarantee you that. So, well, that's all I have today. And I'm sure there are questions coming up. So I'm open for to answer your questions.
Wow. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Jude. And I think it basically captures it, scalability. And that's what we're looking for when you operate in the innovative space, you operate in a startup space. The only way you can get the checks coming in, you can get the deals on the table, is when your business has an ability to be scaled. It has the potential for scalability. And based on what he said and the summary, you cannot scale except you have processes built into your organization, built into what you do. That's when it becomes possible to scale. That's when it becomes possible to standardize. That's when it becomes possible for you to be able to run the business that guarantees and assures the customer of consistent quality. And ultimately, that's when you won't have a business, because then your brand promise can be kept. Thank you very much. And then we'll take I know I think I, like every other person, must have been enjoying that across the platform. I just wanted it to take some time to be able to really, you know, close the latch on many of these topics you talked about, Kaizen, 5S and all that. Yes, a bit tilted towards manufacturing and production, but we do not want also our people to just think that the business of tech or where you employ innovation is only in services. It cuts across the processes, and I think that's a good one. Questions, I'm trying to see. Yes, someone says they're a huge fan of McDonald's systemization here. So true, yeah. How can finance team participate in this thought process? So there's a question about the finance team, you know, unlike them, you know, they're not carrying tools, they're not marking where it should be and all that. I used to think finance has the highest amount of processes, but I'm not a facilitator today. What do you think, Jude? Someone says, how can finance team participate in this thought process? Many service-based organizations, private and public that's a different one. So somebody's asking about finance. How can they participate in this process? Do you have any ideas?
Victor has said, finance actually has a lot of processes. When you're looking at finance, for example, it's not just a, it's not just an optimization or a productivity question anymore. There's also security, because you are dealing with money and you need to be sure that your monies are being spent or going to where they are supposed to go to. So you have clearly defined processes for that. Now, in some cases, you begin to feel that, oh, maybe these processes are actually becoming bottlenecks of their own, because you now have situations where you need to make a payment for things to go out or for things to be delivered. And then the finance guys are going through their own process and all that. Now, the process of solving that is also similar to the production one, where you need to look at the whole process, because you have to ask yourself, what am I trying to achieve? What's the end goal? You don't want to water down your the finance processes so much that you begin to leave loopholes for people to do unscrupulous things. So you now need to look at your process and say, okay, where is the waste here? What are the unnecessary processes in my finance? Or rather, because first, understand that in finance, that's in business finance and accounting, there are processes defined already. For example, you need to raise a payment voucher, you need to issue a purchase order, you need to process, you need to get an invoice. So there are some of those things are important, so you can't eliminate them. So they are not waste. But you will still look at your process and say, okay, where is the waste here? A lot of ways to deal with those things is to use technology. So there are a lot of ERP software that you can use to automate certain actions to reduce repetition. For example, when you are issuing out a purchase order, for example, if you have a software system like an ERP, if you enter it in, so let's assume that the procurement guys enter in the details of what you are buying. The people that will receive it in the store, they don't need to start typing again. They just need to call up the information that's already been entered in the system. When the people that should pay are trying to process the payment, they don't need to start looking for the invoice and all that. So your processes, in setting up processes, you will understand that certain things cannot really be, you can't eliminate certain actions, even though they might be a pain. But you must leave them in place, because those are the things that keep you protected. You can, however, make, so you leave the actions or the activities there, but you now say, okay, how do I make them happen faster? And technology is one of the major ways.
Thank you so much. And I mean, I relate to that. 3-4 years ago, as the chief executive of the business I ran, I on the average signed about 10,000 vouchers a month, authorizing different payments and all that. And of course, when we had to now adopt the enterprise system, I don't even have to do it anymore there. People auditing there. And it's a lot faster. So no matter where I am, people are scanning vouchers and you're writing approvals. There were leakages. There were all manners of things. There were bureaucracy. So you can also improve the process, bearing in mind that it's about introducing efficiency, getting much more done with less resources. I mean, in the world of tech and startup, we talk about bootstrapping. If a typical startup business acts like a traditional established business, you're going to fail. So that's basically what, in summary, Judah has been taking us through. And I'm sure that quite a lot of us will be able to learn. Service industries, no matter what part, what organization you run, a tech startup, it's irrespective of the problem you're solving, standardizing your operations, defining your operations, having SOPs about how processes are done, it's critical. And it's important for you to be able to scale, for your activity to be able to measure, and for you to be able to decide what is working and what's not working, and to improve your productivity. Thank you very much, Jude. And of course, I think it's been a wonderful session talking about improving productivity through processes. It's about making sure what are the processes, how should it be done, what are the sequence, and that way we can drive productivity up the roof and achieve more with less. Thank you, Jude, very much, and we appreciate it. And to everyone who has been a part of, you know, TechBiz webinar today, the 60th webinar series that we've had in the series of webinars. We're quite grateful and we appreciate everyone across all the platforms. Thank you for being a part of it. And I do hope that you've had a wonderful session with our facilitator today and the thought leader in manufacturing process, Mr. Jude Abalaka. For the recording of this session, you will find it by 12 noon tomorrow. It's going to be available. My colleague has just dropped the address. It's going to be at www.ecoicenter.com/webinar, ecoicenter.com/webinar. When you go there, you will see the recording of this session there. And of course, if you do have questions, you can always go to our Telegram page. And of course, my colleagues also have dropped that. All you have to do is join the link through the Telegram page. You can ask questions, we'll respond to you. Most of our facilitators also are there. And you can be able to take the conversation forward in that Telegram space where you have quite a number of thought leaders and experts and subject matter leaders in that platform helping you. Again, this is coming from the Co-Innovation Center, an acceleration hub, which is committed to helping businesses that have innovation and technology at the core of their businesses, helping them achieve commercialization and scale up. And by TechBiz, we try to help them achieve this by bringing thought leaders and people with knowledge of different subject matters to help and provide that handholding that is required for scale up. Thank you for being a part of TechBiz today. I remain your host and the founder of Eco Innovation Center. My name is Victor Gbenga Folabi, and I look forward to having you next week, where we're going to be having another facilitator who is also a subject matter expert in what he will be talking about. He is also someone who plays in the tech space. He'll be talking about rapidly and strategically bringing your startup ideas to life. Rapidly and strategically bringing your startup ideas to life. We'll have a friend of mine for 35 years and an expert in the subject matter of technology, Moses Tunde Aguda. He will be speaking to us 5 p.m. again tomorrow. 5 p.m. next week, Thursday. Keep it a date and be with us again on another edition of TechBiz. Thank you to our facilitator. Thank you for all of you that kept faith with us today. And I look forward to hosting you all again next week, Thursday. Do have a lovely weekend ahead and have a great day.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.